And welcome back to my channel Dentistry Made Easy. The topic for today is periodontal pockets from periodontology. So this is a very important topic from your periodontology that you should know, that is periodontal pockets. So what is the definition of periodontal pocket? It is the pathological deepening of the gingival sulcus, and this is known as periodontal pocket. So now this is the gingiva. So this is the normal gingiva. This is the gingival sulcus. So gingival sulcus, it is a shallow crevice, or it is a space which is present around the tooth, and it is bounded by tooth on one side and it is bounded by gingiva on the other side. So this is your gingival crevice, and this is a normal case. But now over here, as you can see, this is a normal case. When you're inserting the probe into it, so a normal like 2 to 3 mm is a healthy tissue. But when you're inserting the probe, and now you see the measurement, it comes more than 3 mm. So this is nothing but periodontal pocket. So over here, now you can see comparatively. So this is a healthy tissue and this is a diseased tissue. So now your gingival sulcus, it has got deepened, and this is the periodontal pocket. Now don't confuse it with gingival recession. So it's like, it's not always compulsory that your periodontal pocket will have gingival recession, but there are cases like you'll find both, but there's nothing like you'll find gingival recession and it's compulsorily you'll find periodontal pocket too. So in this case, now this is gingival recession in which you can see the root. Now in periodontal pocket, it's not always that you can see the root. It's like when you're probing, at that time the measurement, it is more, and that is your periodontal pocket. So in this case, this is a gingival recession. This is your cemento enamel junction, which is not visible in a normal tooth. It is covered with the gingiva. But now in gingival recession, you can see the root. And this is when you're probing, and this probe goes inside more than 3 mm, and that time it is periodontal pocket. What is the classification of it? Now depending, the first classification is depending on the disease activity. So it can be active or inactive. Next is depending upon the nature of the soft tissue. So how the soft tissue is, whether it is fibrotic or it is edematous, that is swollen type. So it is fibrotic or edematous. The third classification is depending upon the relationship of the bone. So now it is like whether it is infrabony or suprabony. Infrabony is also known as subcrestal or intraalveolar, and suprabony is also known as supracrestal or supraalveolar. So in this case, now you can see suprabony is above the crest of the bone. So this is the crest of the bone. So above that, so that becomes your suprabony, and now your pocket, it has got deepened. So the plaque, it has got more deepened, and it is below the crest of the bone. So this is your infrabony. Next is depending upon the morphology. So it can be gingival or periodontal, or it is combination of both. So gingival is also known as false or pseudo or relative pockets. And periodontal is nothing but true pocket or absolute pocket. So now this is a gingival pocket. Gingival pocket is nothing but it is formed by the gingival enlargement. So when your marginal, so the margins of gingiva, there is this coronal movement of them. So this is the pseudo, that is the gingival pocket, and in periodontal pocket there is destruction of the supporting periodontal tissue. But in gingival pocket, it is the gingival enlargement without destruction of the underlying tissue, or it is combination of both. Then the last classification is depending on the number of surfaces which are included. So it can be simple in this. If there is only one surface which is involved, this is simple. Then compound, when two surfaces are involved. So this is compound. And the third is complex. Complex is also known as spiral. So it is originating, basically it is originating on one surface, and it is twisting around the tooth to involve one or more additional surfaces. So basically it starts like this. So there's this involvement of one surface, and then it gets twisted and it involves more, like one or more additional surfaces. And this is the most commonly found in the furcation area. So this is most commonly found in furcation area. So these are the different classification, how you can classify periodontal pockets as. Now what are the differences between the infrabony and suprabony pocket? So suprabony pockets and infrabony pockets. So the base of the pocket. Now the base of the pocket, it is coronal to the crest of the alveolar bone. So this is your crest of the alveolar bone. So the base of the pocket. So base of the pocket, now if your pocket is present over here. So the base of the pocket, it is coronal to the crest of the bone, and infrabony, it is apical to the crest of the bone. Then the bone loss. The pattern of the bone destruction over here, the pattern of the bone destruction is horizontal, but in infrabony it is vertical or angular. Now you can see it over here. So this is horizontal and it is vertical or angular in infrabony. The third is the lateral wall. So the lateral wall of the pocket, it consists of soft tissue alone in suprabony, and in infrabony the lateral wall, it consists of soft tissue and the bone tissue. It consists both the gingival fibers. So interproximally, the transeptal fibers, they are arranged horizontally. Now over here, so the fibers, they are arranged horizontally in suprabony. In infrabony, the transeptal fibers, they are arranged in oblique pattern. So now you can see it over here, they are arranged in oblique pattern. Then the periodontal fibers, on the facial and the lingual surfaces, the periodontal fibers, they follow the normal horizontal oblique course between the tooth and the bone, like they follow in a normal tooth. So in case of suprabony, they follow that course only. But in infrabony, on the facial and the lingual surface, the periodontal ligament fibers, they follow the angular pattern of the adjacent bone. So how your bone, it has lost, so it follows that pattern. The diagnosis is, clinically, it can be assessed by inserting the probe into the gingival sulcus. So in suprabony, you are diagnosing it by inserting the probe into the gingival sulcus. When the lateral pressure, it is applied, if the soft tissue resistance is felt, then it is diagnosed as suprabony pocket. So when you are like inserting the probe into the sulcus, and when you're applying the pressure, and if soft tissue resistance is felt, then this is suprabony. And in infrabony, now again you are inserting the probe into the gingival sulcus, and when the lateral pressure is applied, if hard tissue resistance is felt, it is diagnosed as infrabony. Because now, as we have seen, the lateral wall of the pocket, it consists of soft tissue in suprabony, and over here it even consists of the bone tissue. And because of that, you'll feel hard tissue resistance in infrabony, and in suprabony you'll feel soft tissue resistance. So this is the difference between the infrabony and the suprabony pockets, and this can be asked as an SAQ in your exams room. The next is a very important like subtopic from periodontal pockets, that is your pathogenesis. So the events in the pathogenesis or the formation of pocket is as follows. So there is this events which makes the pathogenesis of periodontal pocket. So first is formation of bacterial colony. The next is inflammatory process. Third is migration of neutrophils. Fourth is tissue destruction. Then there is activation of neutrophil in connective tissue. And the last is, that is your pocket formation. So now how it occurs, like how the pocket is formed, I'm going to explain with the help of a diagram in short, so that you can like know exactly how it is. So this is the diagram. Now in this case, this is the normal gingiva. So this is your junctional epithelium. So junctional epithelium is, it is a junctional epithelium. So it is the epithelium which has a junction between the tooth and the gingiva. This is a sulcular epithelium and this is the oral epithelium. Sulcular is near the gingival sulcus, is a sulcular epithelium, and junctional epithelium is the junction between the gingiva and the enamel, that is the tooth surface. So now over here, junctional epithelium, it plays an important role in the pathogenesis of periodontal pocket. So this is a normal diagram. Now you can see this is the normal gingival sulcus, that is 2 or 3 mm. So this is the normal one. So the first step was the formation of the bacterial colony. Now the first thing is, the first event in the pocket formation is accumulation of gram-positive bacteria on supragingival tooth surface. So there is this plaque accumulation, and as plaque, it contains bacteria. So there is this accumulation of gram-positive bacteria on the supragingival. So first, to starting off with, there is supragingival accumulation of the plaque and the bacteria, and it is then extended into the gingival sulcus. First there is supragingivally accumulation, then it is extended in the gingival sulcus. So the periodontal pockets, they are caused by the microorganisms and their products, which produce pathologic changes that lead to the deepening of the gingival sulcus. So it's like the periodontal pockets, they are caused by the microorganisms and their products. Then this is the case in which now your plaque, it gets increased when it is not treated supragingivally. So it gets more deepened out, and there is increase in the supragingival plaque and bacteria. And after that, what happens, this plaque and bacteria, it gets involved in the subgingival area. So there is increase in the subgingival plaque and bacteria, and it leads to this finger-like projection of junctional epithelium. So the second step is inflammatory process. So inflammatory process, the pocket formation, it starts as an inflammatory change in the connective tissue wall. So basically your pocket formation, it starts from the inflammatory process. So it's like when the body, it sees that there's an antigen which is present. So to fight against it, there is this inflammatory process, which is nothing but the defense mechanism of the body towards an antigen or towards the bacteria. Now your plaque, it contains bacteria. So to fight against it, so there is this inflammatory process which occurs. So inflammatory process, the pocket formation, it starts as an inflammatory change in the connective tissue wall of the gingival sulcus. So what are the changes? So first thing you'll see is there are changes in this junctional epithelium. So as a result of inflammation, there are this following changes which are seen in the junctional epithelium. So what are the changes that you can see in the junctional epithelium is, now just apical to the junctional epithelium, this is your junctional epithelium. So apical to it, there is the area of destroyed, now your epithelium, it contains collagen fibers. So now this collagen fibers, they are destroyed and it becomes occupied by the inflammatory cells and edema. So this collagen fibers, so the just apical to the junctional epithelium, an area of destroyed collagen fiber, it develops and it is occupied by the inflammatory cells and it is occupied by edema. Then the collagen loss may occur due to, now why this collagen loss is occurring? So it can be due to the enzymes. So now your bacteria, they releases various enzymes. So there is this enzymatic release. So it may be due to the enzymes, which are collagenase and other lysozymal enzymes from PMNs and macrophages. So when this bacteria, it comes in the body, so there's this reaction which occurs between the bacteria and the neutrophils. So these neutrophils, they releases various chemicals, and due to this chemicals, they kill the bacteria, and because of that there is damage of the tissue. So this is nothing but a basic inflammatory process. So what happens now in this? So the collagen loss, it is due to enzymes, and the enzymes, they are released from PMN, that is your neutrophils and macrophages. The next is, now the as a consequence of the loss of this collagen, the apical portion of the junctional epithelium. So this apical portion of the junctional epithelium, it proliferates along the root in the form of finger-like projections. So now this this junctional epithelium, it proliferates and along the root in the form of finger-like projections. So the coronal portion of the gingival of the junctional epithelium, it detaches from the root as the apical portion, it migrates. Thus the sulcus base, it shifts apically, and these will be replaced by the pocket epithelium. So what are the causes for this epithelial cell detachment? So it can be because of the enzymes which are released by the bacteria, or because of the physical force which is exerted by the rapidly growing bacteria, or the bacteria, it may also interfere with the growth and the synthetic activity of the junctional epithelium, of the junctional epithelial cells. So this is nothing but the second step, that is your inflammatory process. So there is this bacterial accumulation in the sulcus, then there is detachment and the apical migration of junctional epithelium. Then it leads to this migration of neutrophils. Now most bacteria, they produce substance that chemotactically attracts neutrophils. So now bacteria, they attract neutrophils. The extension of the plaque subgingivally, it causes an increase in the number of neutrophils. So now the number of neutrophils, they are increasing in the epithelium, and this neutrophil, they adhere to the endothelial cells and they migrate into the connective tissue. After that, what happens is there is this phagocytosis which occurs between the, so the neutrophil, it will engulf the bacteria to kill them. So this is the process of phagocytosis. But during this phagocytosis, it also causes tissue destruction, because there are various chemicals that are released to kill the bacteria, and because of that release of the chemicals, there is tissue destruction. So this is neutrophils in the gingival. So there is neutrophils in the gingival sulcus, and there is phagocytic action of these neutrophils. And the neutrophils, they adhere to the endothelial cells and they migrate into the, so after that it migrates into the connective tissue and they rapidly pass through the junctional epithelium to form a thick layer that covers the surface of the subgingival plaque. Upon arrival at the plaque surface, the ability of the neutrophils to limit further extension and spread of the bacteria by phagocytosis may be inhibited by lipopolysaccharides and leukotoxins. So this is migration of neutrophils. Nothing but there is this phagocytic process, phagocytic actions of the neutrophil. Then there is tissue destruction and activation of neutrophils in connective tissue. Now, as we have seen, these neutrophils, they get into the connective tissue. And they lead to, due to this phagocytic action, there is tissue destruction. So increasing growth rate of the bacteria, it swamps the neutrophil system and it permits the tissue destruction to occur. So what happens is there is more and more bacteria now. So because of that, there is more bacteria and less neutrophils. And this will lead to tissue destruction. So the pocket epithelium, it causes this open communications between the pockets and the connective tissue. So this was your epithelium and this is the connective tissue. So there is this open communication which occurs because of this, between this epithelium and the connective tissue, that is nothing but ulceration. Then the pocket epithelium, it causes this open communication. Because of this, the connective tissue, it becomes flooded with the bacterial substances and the bacteria, it enters the connective tissue. Now this epithelium, it was guiding this connective tissue. But now there is this open communication which occurs. So now this bacteria, it gets into this connective tissue and this connective tissue, it is flooded with bacteria. Now as soon as the bacterial substance has entered the connective tissue, many systems are activated. So now it's like over here, the things were happening, like the bacteria and the neutrophil activities were going on in the epithelium. But now the bacteria, it has entered the connective tissue. So as soon as this bacteria, when it enters the connective tissue, the various systems, that is the defensive systems like macrophages, lymphocytes, complement system, they get activated in the connective tissue. And this is the activation of neutrophils. The neutrophil now, they encounter this bacterial substances within the connective tissue. So now there is this phagocytic action of the neutrophils in connective tissue and phagocytic action of the macrophages. So this neutrophil, it becomes activated and they undertake the phagocytosis with resultant release of lysosomal enzymes, collagenase and other substances that causes extensive tissue destruction. So now this is like, now your epithelial was getting destructed, but now the bacteria has entered in the connective tissue. So now even there is more destruction. So there is extensive tissue destruction. So this results in the loss of cohesiveness and the tissue detachment from the tooth surface. Thus, the bottom of the sulcus, it shifts apically, resulting in deepening of the pocket. And this causes the pocket formation. Once the epithelial barrier, it is breached. So once there is this formation of ulceration, the gradient of the chemotactic action, it is released by the pocket bacteria, it may be disrupted. So what is chemotaxis? Chemotaxis is nothing but it's like a guided, so it's like a directed migration of the cells to respond to the concentration gradients of the extracellular signals. So now this is disrupted because of the epithelial barrier, as the epithelial barrier is breached. So when the epithelial barrier, it is re-established, the chemotactic gradient, it is formed again and the destructive process, it subsides. So after that, it's like when the treatment is done. So this chemotactic gradient, which was disrupted, it is formed again and the destructive process, it subsides when you're removing this plaque. So if this barrier, it is not re-established, tissue destruction, it continues and the alveolar bone is resorbed. And this is like a periodontal pocket is now established, which leads to bone loss. So this is like the whole pathogenesis of the formation of periodontal pockets. So this is the diagram and this is a flowchart form of this same thing that I have explained. So now this is again the same thing of what I have explained, but like in more detailed form. So it's like a different proportions of bacterial cell in dental plaque. It leads to inflammatory changes. So there are more number of spirochetes and motile rods that are gram negative. Then there is degeneration of the surrounding connective tissue. Then there is apical shift of the gingival of the junctional epithelium. And this is like there are two mechanisms. So there is loss of collagen fibers. As we have seen, there was loss of collagen fibers. It was because of these two factors. So there were these two mechanisms. So over here there is this collagenase and other enzymes that are produced. And then there is extension of the phagocytic secretor by the PMNs in the epithelium, and which in final leads to the loss of collagen fibers. So there is this proliferation of the inflammatory cells, and then there is bacterial enzymes and physical forces, and the apical, there is migration of the apical portion, which is replaced by the pocket epithelium, and there is this deattachment of the coronal portion, which leads to aggressive growth and the action. So the bacteria, it gets into the connective tissue, it is more and more grown. Then there is immigration, so of the neutrophils in large amount. So now your neutrophils also, they entered in the connective tissue. So like I have explained everything in the last part. Then there is disruption of the epithelial barrier, causing open communication, and your neutrophils, they are entered into the, so the bacteria, it gets entered into the connective tissue. And there is loss of chemotactic gradient. So there is tissue destruction. Then there is resorption of the bone because of this tissue destruction, which leads to establishment of the periodontal pocket. Now what is histopathologically? So now in histopathologically, you have to see three things. So there is this lateral wall of pocket. So lateral wall of pocket, or it is a soft tissue wall or a gingival wall of pocket, it forms the lateral wall of the periodontal pocket. So these are the zones of the lateral wall. So first zone is area of relative quiescence. Second is bacterial accumulation. Because of this bacterial accumulation, there is this emergence of leukocytes. So basically, it's nothing but like a pathogenesis. So there is this emergence of leukocytes. Because of this emergence of leukocytes, there is this interaction between the leukocytes and bacteria. Because of that, there is epithelial desquamation. This epithelial desquamation, it leads to ulcerations. Then the last zone, zone 7, is area of hemorrhage with numerous erythrocytes. So this is like a microtopography or zones of lateral wall. Now, what are the changes that we'll see in the lateral wall? So the changes is now the blood vessels. So this blood vessels, they will be overfilled with blood and they are dilated. The next change you'll see is now the connective tissue, it is edematous and it is densely infiltrated with the plasma cells, lymphocytes and neutrophils. So what is the histopathology of lateral wall? So first is the epithelium. So the epithelium along the lateral wall of the pocket, it presents a degenerative changes, proliferative and degenerative changes. Because of that only this tissue destruction is occurred. Then because of this tissue destruction, you will see this degenerative changes which occurs at the lateral wall of the pocket. Then this epithelial projections, it extends deep into the connective tissue and also extends further apically than the junctional epithelium. So there was this finger-like projection. So that is this epithelial projections. The third is the epithelium, it is infiltrated. So now your epithelium, it is infiltrated with leukocytes and other inflammatory. Now as your bacteria is, it has entered the this epithelium. So now to overcome, so to fight against it, the epithelium is now infiltrated with leukocytes and other inflammatory cells. The next is there is degeneration and necrosis of the epithelium, leading to ulcerations. So there was this destruction, tissue destruction at epithelium, and there was this ulceration formation and exposure of the underlying connective tissue. So these is like the histopathology of the lateral wall. And the last is the bacterial invasion along the lateral and the apical areas of the pocket. So some bacteria, it transfers the basement lamina and it invades the subepithelial connective tissue. So these are the histopathology of the lateral wall. So the next is the root surface of the pocket. So the root surface wall of the periodontal pocket, they often undergo changes that are significant because there are this periodontal infection which causes pain and it may complicate the periodontal treatment. So the root surface of the pocket, it may complicate the treatment. So what are the root surface changes that you can see? So there are the changes which you can see is structural changes. So your first change you can see is in the structure. So now there is this exposure of the cementum to the oral environment. So there can be exposure of the cementum to the oral environment. So because of that, the minerals which are present in the saliva, they get deposited on the cementum surface. So this like minerals which are present in the saliva, they are deposited on the cementum. Minerals like calcium, fluoride. So because of that, there is areas of hypermineralization. So the root surface is now exposed to the oral fluid and bacterial plaque. Now the root surface is also like it is exposed to the oral fluids and bacterial plaque. Because of that, there is proteolysis of the remnants of the Sharpe's fibers, and this leads to areas of demineralization, and this leads to root caries, which you can see as a yellowish or light brown patches. And when you're probing, you'll see that soft and lethargic feeling when you're probing. So the patient, he feels severe sensitivity to thermal changes and sweats, and in severe forms there can be pulp exposure. So these are the structural changes that you'll see in the root surface of the pocket. The chemical changes that you can see are the cementum, which are exposed to the saliva, it may absorb calcium, phosphorus, magnesium and fluorides. Because of this, the mineral content of the cementum is increased. So it alters the chemical composition of the cementum, making it resistant to dental caries. So these are the chemical changes. But now in this case, if some harmful products are absorbed during this, so they can be toxic to it. And the last changes are cytotoxic. So bacterial penetration into the cementum, it can be found as deep as cemento-dentinal junction. In addition, the bacterial products such as endotoxins have been detected. So these are the changes that you'll see on the root surface of the pocket. What are the zones at the base? Now, what are the zones that you'll find at the base of the periodontal pocket? So these are the zones that you'll see at the base of the pocket. So first zone, it is the cementum, which is covered by the calculus. The second is the zone of attached plaque. So it covers the calculus and it extends apically from it to a variable degree. So it can be like 100 to 500 microns. The extent of it is 100 to 500 microns. The third zone is the zone of unattached plaque. So it surrounds the attached plaque and it extends apically to it. The next is the zone of attachment of junctional epithelium to the tooth. So this zone, it is reduced to 100 microns in periodontal pocket from 500 microns, which was found in normal sulcus. So now this junctional epithelium, now in normal sulcus, you will see this zone, it is 500 microns. But now this zone in periodontal pocket, in case of periodontal pocket, it has decreased, it has reduced to 100 microns. And then this last zone is zone of semi-destroyed connective tissue fibers, which is apical to the junctional epithelium. So this is the semi-destroyed connective tissue fibers. So these are the zones which you'll find at the base of the periodontal pocket. So what are the contents of this periodontal pocket? So these are the contents. So you'll find gingival crevicular fluid, food debris, salivary mucin, desquamated epithelial cells and leukocytes, then bacteria and their products like enzymes, endotoxins, metabolic products. Then sometimes they even have purulent exudate containing living or degenerated neutrophils, dead and living bacteria. So these are the contents of the periodontal pocket, what you'll see in the periodontal pocket. So this was the first part of your periodontal pocket, and this was it of the first part. Now in second part, I'll cover the clinical features of it, the correlation between the clinical and the histological features. So there's this correlation. Because of this histological feature, you'll see some clinical feature because of that particular histologic feature. So there is this correlation between clinical and histologic feature. Then how you are going to diagnose the case? That is the identification of pocket. So how you are going to diagnose? How are you going to like detect pseudo pockets? Then the true pockets. Then how you are going to detect infrabony and suprabony pockets? Then there are these critical zones which you will find in periodontal pocket that I am going to cover in the next part of it. And the last and most important part of it is the management of pocket. So I'm going to cover the treatment modalities for the true, pseudo, suprabony and infrabony pockets. Because now the diagnosis of it, basically which type of pocket it is. So that type, so the treatment modality, it changes depending upon which type of pocket it is. If it is true, then the treatment will be different for it than pseudo. If it is supra bony, then the treatment modality, it will be different and it will be much simpler than obviously infra bony pockets. So I'm going to cover everything about it in the next part of it. So this was it of this video. Thank you so much.